Hello, Bea here. Today in biology, we're going to be talking about DNA. Good timing, too, because I just sent off my DNA to be analyzed. In a few weeks, I'll get all sorts of information about diseases I may be at risk for, where my ancestors came from, and possibly even find some new, long-lost family members. It was so easy. I just took a quick swab from my mouth, popped it in the envelope, and mailed it off. From that little bit of DNA I collected, they'll be able to get all sorts of information. But what is DNA? Now that so many companies are making these simple test-from-home kits, you probably hear about it all the time. It turns out that DNA is a specific kind of molecule that gives our body instructions. These instructions control noticeable things like appearance, but also control all of our body's functions and processes that keep us alive. In this lesson, we'll look at how a DNA molecule is structured and organized. And as we go through the rest of this unit, we'll study the processes that use our DNA to make proteins. After today's lesson, you'll be able to describe the structure of a DNA or RNA molecule, explain the relationship between nucleotides, genes, chromosomes, and DNA, summarize the way that chromosomes are organized and inherited in different species. Do you remember what a macromolecule is? We learned about them a few units ago. Macromolecule just means a large molecule. The three macromolecules you have learned about so far are carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins. The fourth category of macromolecule will be the focus of this lesson, nucleic acids. Nucleic acids are the macromolecules that make up DNA and RNA. Just like the other macromolecules, nucleic acids can be further broken down into specific building blocks. These building blocks are called nucleotides. There are five different types of nucleotides: adenine, thymine, uracil, cytosine, and guanine. Wow, those names are a mouthful. Usually we just refer to them by their first letters: A, T, U, G, and C. And speaking of letters, it is helpful to think of these five bases as an alphabet. It's the alphabet that DNA uses to make the equivalent of words. By combining these letters in different ways, your DNA can have a seemingly infinite array of different words or instructions. Before we look at how nucleotides go together to make DNA and RNA, let's look at the structure of a single nucleotide. All nucleotides have a phosphate group and a sugar. Attached to the sugar is the nitrogenous base that determines which nucleotide it is. Remember the five letters? A, T, U, G, and C. The nitrogenous base will be one of these five structures. And why do you think we call it the nitrogenous base? Let's zoom in on those bases and take a look. In addition to carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, which we are used to seeing in macromolecules, what else do they have in common? They all have at least two nitrogens. I know you've heard of DNA, but do you know what it stands for? Deoxyribonucleic acid. No wonder we usually just say DNA. But notice that nucleic acid is in the name, because it's made of nucleic acids, which are built from nucleotides. But DNA only contains four of the five nucleotides we've learned: A, T, G, and C. No U's, or uracil, are present in DNA. The nucleotides go together to make a double helix structure. Imagine taking a tall ladder and twisting it over and over again. That's what DNA looks like. The sugar and phosphate parts of the nucleotide make up the backbone, or sides, of the ladder, and the nitrogenous bases, A, T, C, and G, are the rungs that connect in the middle. Notice that the bases always exist in pairs, and that they always pair with the same letter. A and T go together, while G and C go together. I'm guessing you had heard of DNA before our lesson today, but what about RNA? We can think of ribonucleic acid as being DNA's cousin. It's also made of nucleic acid. Its name is just missing the deoxy prefix at the beginning. While they are both made of nucleotides and have a helical structure, there are some noticeable differences between DNA and RNA. The most obvious difference is that RNA is single-stranded. It's like one side of our ladder is missing. And if you look closely, you'll notice a difference in the nucleotide bases as well. RNA does not use the thymine nucleotide. Instead, it uses uracil. There are three important types of RNA that we will talk about in upcoming lessons: mRNA, tRNA, and rRNA. Remember that DNA stores the instructions for making protein, but RNA is more directly involved in the process that actually makes the protein, using those instructions. We'll look at that process in more detail later. If we were to look at a full set of human DNA, it would contain around 3 billion nucleotides. That's 3 billion pairs of A's and T's and G's and C's. The entire set of DNA in an organism is called a genome. So we can say that the human genome consists of 3 billion nucleotides. But that genome is divided up into segments, or genes. Each gene codes for one or more proteins. A single gene may only consist of a few hundred nucleotides, or it could be as many as 200,000. In order to produce all of the protein that our bodies need to function, our DNA has around 25,000 total genes. Because many genes can make multiple proteins, our bodies produce at least 100,000 different types of protein molecules. And remember that all of this variety comes from an alphabet of just 4 different nucleotides. Of course, not all 100,000 proteins are made by all cells. Most cells only use a small portion of the genes in your DNA. They only need to use the genes that are relevant to their job. It may be helpful to think of our genome as a big library with many, many instruction books arranged in different sections on different shelves. These different books represent our genes. As a reader, you probably won't ever read all of the books. You will pick and choose the ones that are useful to you at different times. You're like the cell, using only the parts of the genome it needs. Other readers, or other cells, will use different books or different genes. Now, if you've been doing the math in your head, come on, I know you're a human calculator, you may have noticed that the numbers don't quite add up. Even at 25,000 genes, and possibly thousands of nucleotides per gene, that still doesn't get us anywhere close to using up all 3 billion nucleotides that are in our genome. It is thought that only around 3% of human DNA codes for protein. The rest of those nucleotides are called non-coding DNA. If it doesn't code for a protein, why in the world do we have it? And have so much of it? Well, surprisingly, I don't have a great answer for you here. At one time, scientists thought it was mostly junk DNA, but now they are discovering that it may play a role in controlling the activity of genes. But there's still a lot we haven't figured out about it. A chromosome is a strand of DNA that is wrapped tightly around itself and around proteins called histones. The bundle of DNA and histones is called chromatin. Remember that DNA in the form of chromosomes is found in the nucleus of the cell. To fit all of your genetic information into each of your cells, it has to be wound up very tightly. Imagine taking a long rope and winding it around itself until you made a tight bundle. If the DNA in a single chromosome was stretched out, it would be several inches long. And if all of your DNA in a single cell was unraveled, it would be at least 5 feet long. Our 25,000 genes are divided into 23 different chromosomes, but they're not divided equally. The smallest chromosome only has 55 genes, while the largest has nearly 2,000 genes. Any guess where our chromosomes come from? Your chromosomes came from your mom and dad. Your chromosomes came from your parents. It is easiest to study chromosomes by looking at a karyotype. A karyotype is an image that shows the complete set of chromosomes. This is an example of a human karyotype. You have a chromosome number 1 from mom and a chromosome number 1 from dad. Then you have a chromosome number 2 from mom and a chromosome number 2 from dad, and so on. Notice that there are 46 total chromosomes, but they are arranged into 23 pairs. The 23rd pair of chromosomes is labeled either X or Y and determines whether you are male or female. We'll talk more about that in a later lesson. Talking about the number of chromosomes can be confusing because sometimes we say that humans have 46 chromosomes and sometimes we say 23. It depends on whether we mean the total number of chromosomes or the number of pairs, which tells us how many different kinds of chromosomes we have. To avoid confusion, we use the terms haploid and diploid. Haploid refers to the number of pairs of chromosomes, so the human haploid number is 23. Diploid refers to the total number, which is 46 for humans. The easy way to remember this is that haploid starts with the word half, and it's half the total number. Diploid starts with the same letter as double and is double the number of pairs. What are the haploid and diploid numbers in this example? There are 3 different types of chromosomes, so the haploid number is 3. But each of those 3 chromosomes would have a corresponding chromosome that came from the other parent, for a diploid number of 6. But aren't there supposed to be 23 pairs of chromosomes? Well, that's only if we are talking about humans. Different species have different numbers of chromosomes. You might assume that larger, more complex species have more chromosomes than simple organisms, and sometimes that seems to be the case. But the numbers can be a little random too. Can you guess which animal has the highest number of chromosomes? It's the Atlas blue butterfly with 225 pairs of chromosomes. It's pretty for sure, but you probably wouldn't have guessed that was the answer. Others that may surprise you: dogs and chickens both have 39 pairs, and even a potato plant has 24 pairs. All of those beat our haploid number of 23. It turns out that the number of chromosomes isn't that useful in determining the size or complexity of an organism. As we wrap up our lesson, let's review what we have learned. We looked at the structure of DNA and RNA molecules, including the 5 nucleotides that make them up. We also discovered how DNA is kept within the cell. Specifically, it is kept within the nucleus, sometimes found in tightly coiled chromosomes. Next, we learned that chromosomes are inherited, producing a karyotype of 23 pairs of chromosomes in humans, and different numbers in other species. Remember that DNA is our genetic material that determines our physical traits and allows our bodies to carry out all the processes that keep us alive. I'll leave you with a quick preview of what we'll be doing next time. You may already know that most of the cells in your body have to be replaced. Some only live for a few days. If the cell is replaced, the DNA has to be replaced as well. Otherwise, the new cells wouldn't know what to do. How does DNA make a copy of itself? We'll look at that process in depth. Until then, I am looking forward to getting my DNA results back. I can't wait to see all the information hiding in my double helix. And remember, biology is more than just science. It's the way of life. Hey, hey.